This is Nagajyoti, working as an assistant professor in department of ECE in St. Peter's Engineering College. So today I want to discuss about a course of linear IC applications of Unit 1, Part 3. So the complete linear IC applications deals with an op-amp. What is a op-amp? What are the different characteristics of an op-amp and what are the different modes of an operations of an op-amp. So in the last two sessions we have discussed about AC and DC characteristics of an op-amp. So in this session let us discuss about what are the ideal values of an op-amp and in how many ways the op-amp can be operated and what are the applications of an op-amp and how to calculate gain of an op-amp. So coming to the first one, ideal values of an op-amp. So in case of an op-amp, we are having AC characteristics as well as DC characteristics. But among AC and DC characteristics, we should know what must be the ideal value and what are the practical values which we are getting. So the first one is open loop voltage gain. So we know that a voltage gain is a ratio of output voltage towards the input voltage. But whereas in case of an op-amp, as it consists of two input terminals, that is inverting and non-inverting, the op-amp basic function is to amplify the difference of the signal, that is open loop voltage gain of an op-amp should be as high as possible, which indicates that it is amplifying the difference of the signals and it is rejecting the common signals. The second one is input impedance. So we know that the op-amp will not allow any current to enter into it. So if the current value of an op-amp is equivalent to zero, the impedance of such an op-amp should be as maximum as possible. So the ideal value should be equivalent to infinite. And in case of an op-amp, it is used in order to amplify the signals. That is, whatever the input voltage which we are applying, the output voltage should be greater than that of the input voltage. So the output impedance of an op-amp should be as minimum as possible. We should be approximately equal to zero. And the op-amp must have the capability to allow all the frequency ranges from minimum value towards the maximum value. So here the bandwidth specifies, it is the difference between upper cutoff frequency and lower cutoff frequency. So the bandwidth of an op-amp should be infinite, which indicates that op-amp must have a capability to allow as maximum frequencies as possible. The next one is zero offset voltage, which indicates that whenever we are not applying any signals to an op-amp, the output voltage should be equivalent to zero. But we won't get the output voltage equal to zero because of two reasons. The first one is, as an op-amp consists of n number of transistors, no two transistors will have identical values of an HFE. So because of different HFE values, the output will not be equivalent to zero. And the second one is, due to the power supply voltages what we are applying, due to that we'll be getting some sort of voltage at the output. Next one is common mode rejection ratio. What is the ratio of different signal gain by common mode gain? That is, op-amp must have the capability to amplify only the different signals. That is the reason the common mode rejection ratio should be as high as possible, which is infinite. The next one is slew rate, which specifies that it is a derivative of an output voltage with respect towards the time. Means for every change in 1 microsecond, what will be the change at the corresponding voltage is called as a slew rate. Next is no effect of temperature. Means whenever there is change in the temperature, the voltages and currents of an op amp should not be vary. So if an op amp is very less sensitive towards the temperature, then it is said to be good op amp. Similarly, whenever there is change in the power supplies, there should not be change in any voltages and currents of an op amp. So the power supply rejection ratio should be as minimum as possible. So these are the ideal characteristic values of an op amp. The next is modes of using an op amp. So we can use the op amp in two different modes. One is open loop mode and the second one is closed loop mode. So here, what is meant by an open loop mode is, as we know that an op amp consists of two terminals, inverting and non-inverting. If you are applying two signals, V1 and V2, for inverting and non-inverting terminals, then the gain will be equal to infinite. That is, output voltage will be varying between positive saturation or a negative saturation depending upon whether V1 is greater than V2 or V2 is greater than V1. So always in case of an open loop mode, the output will be having only two values, that is either plus Vsat or minus Vsat. Due to this reason, the op amp can be used as a switch. So if we are using op amp in an open loop configuration, we have limited number of applications. So the applications of an op amp in open loop configuration are voltage comparator, zero crossing detector, and so on. So if you want to increase the utility of an op amp, instead of using an op amp in an open loop configuration, we need to use in the closed loop configuration, in which the output should be fed back towards the input with a negative feedback. So if we are providing a feedback path from output towards the input, the op amp will not be driven into saturation, but the op amp can be operated in a linear mode. So in case of an open loop configurations, the output depends only on the input because there is no feedback path from output towards the input, and the op amp will have high gain amplifier. And we can use the op amp in three different modes of configurations. One is differential mode, second is open loop configuration, and the third one is inverting and non-inverting configurations. So before going for the inverting and non-inverting amplifiers, we must understand the concept of virtual ground. So if we observe the figure, this is a figure of inverting op amp. Why we are saying it as an inverting op amp is, for the inverting terminal, that is for negative terminal, we are giving the input voltage Vin, but the other terminal is grounded. As we are giving output towards the input, then it is called as closed loop configuration. So in this case, the op amp will provide infinite voltage gain. As we know that voltage gain is nothing but output voltage by input voltage, but the ideal value of an op amp which is having a voltage gain of infinite, that specifies the gain value is equal to infinite. If gain is equal to infinite, which represents the input voltage is equal to zero. So input voltage is zero specifies that there is a difference between the voltages at inverting terminal and non-inverting terminal, that is Vin will amplify the different signals of those two, which is equivalent to V2 minus V1. But in this circuit, one of the terminal, that is positive terminal of an op amp, is connected towards the ground. So V1 value is equivalent to 0. If V1 value is equivalent to 0, if you substitute V1 equal to 0, and because of gain is infinite, Vin is also 0. So substitute the value of Vin as 0 and V1 as 0, then V2 will also become it as 0. Means whatever the voltage which is present at the positive terminal of an op amp will be having same voltage across an inverting terminal of an op amp. This concept is called as a virtual ground. Or in simple way, in this figure, as positive terminal is grounded, the voltage across that positive terminal is 0. Because of this virtual ground concept, the voltage across the inverting terminal is also is equivalent to 0. The basic virtual ground concept is used in order to simplify the equations in an op amp. So let us discuss about the inverting op amp. So as I have told you in the previous thing, such that op amp can be used either in open loop or closed loop, but only in the closed loop configurations we can increase our utility of an op amp by connecting the input either towards the inverting or towards the non-inverting or to both the terminals. So in this case, as we are giving the output towards the input, it is connected in a closed loop configuration, and here we are giving the supply towards the negative terminal. That is the reason it is called as an inverting amplifier. So in this inverting amplifier, output is connected with a feedback path to produce a closed loop configuration. And we need to remember two important rules in inverting amplifiers. Those are, as we know that the input impedance of an op amp is infinite, that itself indicates no current flows into the input terminals of an op amp. And the second is, because of virtual ground concept, whatever the voltage which is present at the positive terminal of an op amp should be equivalent towards the negative terminal of an op amp. So here the differential voltage is equivalent to 0 because of virtual ground concept. So by applying these two rules, we need to derive the expression for voltage gain of an inverting op amp. So this is a figure for an inverting op amp. As the name itself indicates, inverting op amp, so we are connecting input signal to the negative terminal of an op amp and the positive terminal of an op amp should be grounded. And in order to derive the voltage gain, that is the voltage gain is defined as a ratio of output voltage towards the input voltage. So here voltage gain is represented by AV, output voltage by input voltage. Now we need to write down the equations from this circuit. So as we are applying the input for the inverting terminal, the current flowing through the inverting terminal is II and the resistance across that is RI. So here according to the Ohm's law, that is V equal to I into R, but the difference of those two voltages are VI minus V1 equal to current is IY into RI. Similarly, going towards the feedback path, that is VI minus V0, V1 minus V0 is equivalent to IF into RF. But we know that according to the two rules which we have seen, the first is no current is going to be entered into an op amp. So here I1 current should be is equivalent towards the IF current. So whatever the current, II current which is flowing should be is equivalent to that of the IF current. So if we substitute those values, we can write down the expression as VI minus V1 equal to, instead of representing it as II, we are now representing it as IF. So VI minus V1 equal to IF into RA. Similarly, V1 minus V0 equal to IF into RF. And according to the second rule, that is virtual ground concept, whatever the voltage which is present at V2 should be equivalent to V1. So the voltage across V2 is 0, so the voltage across V1 should also be equal to 0. So substitute the value of V1 equal to 0. So we'll be getting VI minus 0 equal to IF into RI, and 0 minus V0 equal to IF into RF. So from these two equations, if you manipulate the equations in such a way that V0 by VI, we'll be getting V0 by VI equal to minus RF by RI. So here V0 by VI is nothing but gain. So we can represent the voltage gain of an inverting op amp as minus RF by RI, where RF is a feedback resistance and RI is a input resistance. And here the negative sign represents there is a 180 degree phase shift between the input as well as output of an op amp. So if we are giving a sine wave which is varying from 0 towards positive to negative value, the output of an op amp will be having a waveform of sine which is varying from 0 to negative towards a positive. So here negative sign represents there is a 180 degrees phase shift between the input and output. This is all about how to calculate the gain of an inverting op amp. The next one is non-inverting amplifier. So here in case of a non-inverting amplifier, we need to apply the voltage, that is input voltage should be applied towards the non-inverting terminals, that is positive terminal. So here the positive terminal is connected with some voltage source and negative terminal should be grounded. So according to the virtual ground concept, the voltage across a positive terminal is not equal to zero. So there will be some voltage present across V1. So here we are applying KCL at node 1. So the KCL is nothing but the sum of incoming current should be equivalent towards the outgoing currents. So here incoming currents to an op amp is I1 and outgoing currents is equivalent to I2. So we need to write down the expression in terms of I1 should be equivalent to I2. So as the first, that is negative terminal, is grounded, the voltage, you are not applying any voltage, 0 minus VI, and the input resistance is R1 is equivalent to VI minus V0 by R2. And if you change these expressions in such a way that output voltage gain is equivalent to AV into VI, or voltage gain equal to output voltage by input voltage, if we simplify these expressions, we'll be getting a voltage gain of a non-inverting amplifier as 1 plus R2 by R1. Here R2 is a resistance which is present in the feedback path and R1 is a resistance present at the input. So in general, we can say that the voltage gain of a non-inverting amplifier is 1 plus RF by R1. But the voltage gain of an inverting amplifier is minus RF by R1. So as we are applying the input to the non-inverting terminal, in this case we won't get any phase shift between the input and output. So let us see the comparison of inverting and non-inverting amplifier. So in the first, the voltage gain in an inverting amplifier is minus RF by R1, but whereas the voltage gain for the non-inverting is 1 plus Rf by R1. So as there is a negative sign represents there is a phase shift between input and output. But whereas in case of a non-inverting, there is no phase shift between input and output. And as we are having voltage gain minus Rf by R1, this voltage gain can be adjusted as greater than, less than or equal to depending upon the resistance values. But whereas in case of a non-inverting amplifier, as voltage gain is 1 plus Rf by R1, even though we can change the values of Rf and R1, always the voltage gain will be greater than 1 in case of an ideal non-inverting amplifier. And the input impedance is R1, and the input impedance is very large when compared towards the inverting amplifier. This is all about how to calculate the voltage gain of an inverting and non-inverting amplifiers.